Could you tell me what your experience in filmmaking has been like? Where did you go to school? What led you up to this particular movie?
It's sort of a long-winded answer because my evolution into film started in a totally different discipline. So I went to Yale as an undergrad, and I was a chemistry major there. And I was also pre-med. So I was planning to go to medical school and eventually got my master's at USC at the medical school there in global medicine, which was a program that really kind of helped crystallize my interest in making a documentary about this particular subject matter. So it was through the Congo documentary, which was actually my first film, that I came to the conclusion that I wanted to do film full time. I was always interested sort of peripherally in film. I wrote screenplays as a hobby, but never fully made the commitment to do that as a career, with going into medicine, like I said. So I definitely kind of did a bit of a 180, and the film was kind of that pivot point for me. So that's how I got into film. And then in terms of this particular issue and this film specifically, when I was an undergraduate at Yale, I met a woman who was Congolese who I became friendly with and sort of introduced me to the conflict that was happening in the region. She had left it behind years ago, but things were already starting to kind of implode there when she left. And we had sort of a superficial friendship, and it was through her that my interest peaked, and I went on kind of a journey of self-education to learn more about this region and this place that was called the Rape Capital of the World by the UN. And always being passionate about women's issues, I wanted to learn more. And that, again, evolved over a few years. Through my master's program, I was able to gain the tools to make a more responsible film, I think, a film that had, something of an academic perspective. I was more educated on what was happening in the region in terms of NGOs, which I'm sure you learned about in your master's, and what they were doing in the area,
Not
and
good
the history of the
things.
conflict. What's that?
Not always good things.
Right, exactly. So, it was a real evolution over the course of a few years, from my first learning about the issue to my decision to make the film, and then finally the process of raising the money to make it, going out there shooting it, and then all the way through post-production. I'd say that spanned a few years.
When did filming start? Was that around 2012 or?
Yeah, it was after the actual crisis. The rape happened in 2012, and then the trial was about a year and a half after. So the trial itself happened a couple years after the rape. So it took a fair amount of time for them to kind of get the infrastructure in place to be able to have something like this.
I want to talk about the whole getting the trial together, the UN and The Hague. I noticed that you posted an article about how things are after the fact, and The Hague has only recognized that women being used as a weapon is a thing that we can convict people of. Which I found really strange since the UN resolution, what is it, 1325, had already established that. So that's really disappointing.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's tremendous work that still needs to be done. I mean, obviously internationally, and then very specifically in Congo. I think the trial, as you saw in the film, was handled with a real degree of insensitivity, and it was almost farcical. So there's a lot more that needs to happen there. I think this was a positive step in the right direction, just because bringing something like this to trial was really unprecedented. But it represents just the first stepping stone and what needs to be really kind of a long road to really achieving justice.
It absolutely is. I want to talk more about the shots that you got of the trial itself. But first I would like to ask you, was it difficult to find like on camera interviews, like willing participants while shooting? Did the women seem like they were okay with being asked these questions? How difficult was that?
For the one-on-one interviews or during the trial itself?
The one-on-one interviews. I think you talked to maybe 3 or 4 women.
Yeah, well, I actually spoke to many more women than that even. Those were the interviews that made it into the film, but I have a number of other interviews that at some point I would like to cut into their own standalone pieces. Mm-hmm. But it's in terms of the ones that you see in the film, all of the interviews were tremendously challenging to get, both logistically, just in accessing these women who are so far out in the bush, in a country that really lacks infrastructure, so there's no road systems, and also the threats of, you know, the rebel activity in the region. And then, more importantly, in terms of just emotionally being able to engage with the women who were telling such intimate, you know, details of the most traumatic event of their life.
Mm-hmm.
So that took a lot of time, sitting down, making people feel comfortable with my presence and my motivation, being very honest about what I was trying to do with the film, and also letting people know that I was not interested in making a film that victimized these women. I needed to make a film that was honest, and a real part of that story is the incredible resilience of these women. I mean, they are like superheroes. I mean, it's incredible what they do and what they've overcome. So I let all the women know that I was going to be handling their stories with sensitivity and dignity, which is what they deserve. And I think that they trusted me on that, and that helped kind of open the dialogue.
I think that came across in the film. You don't really need the voice of the narrator, that overarching narrator. I think the voices of the subjects is probably more important and powerful. And especially these women telling the story or the testimony themselves is even greater. So I definitely feel you when you say, you know, it's a bit of a tightrope to make sure you handle these stories delicately. But I think you did a pretty good job. And I was going to ask, were the women that you spoke to, the ones on camera, did it seem like they were at least a little hopeful about the future? 'Cause I did get that sense near the end.
It depended on the individual and where they were living. So I saw a pretty extreme split between the urban life and the rural one for women in eastern Congo. So women who are living way out in the bush, in villages, definitely had a more pessimistic outlook in terms of their futures and the future of their children than the women living in the more urban communities where there was modest access to education, other endeavors such as the artist who was based in the city of Goma. But other women, such as the one who opens and closes the film, the woman with the yellow headscarf, who was an unbelievable story. I mean, just incredible. She definitely was less optimistic about the future, having a daughter who was already, you know, killed at the hands of the rebels, and then, you know, not really able to access education for her other children. So it was sort of split on that, and it was very much reflected by which community they were a part of.
Okay. And a question about that community. I noticed, and this happens quite a bit in areas that deal with ethnic genocide, not that this is the case here, but women who are attacked generally do not receive, you know, support from their families or their communities. And when I saw these women talk about, oh, my husband left me forever, or there's whisperings in the community that say, oh, she's a rape victim, I was upset, but not surprised. Do you think that there is maybe a shared responsibility for the well-being of women and children in DRC? Is it not just the military and the government, but the strength of a community itself?
Of course, yes. That stigmatization of women who are victims of rape is so deeply entrenched in the culture. It spans everything from government, military, to the minutia of the community. You know, mothers, fathers, families, they're all affected by this, and they all factor into the way that we receive survivors, and they bear a burden in this and a responsibility in it. And absolutely, I saw that so often the most damaging repercussion of rape was the total exclusion of the women by their communities. So I definitely think that creates a real problem, because for women, if they have a support system in their husbands and their families and their parents, they have something to return to after a rape. If they're dismissed and cast out, not only do they lose their ability to survive financially, but they lose that bedrock, and that has a real fracturing effect.
Yes. Okay. And one of the women who was helping to try to build her own community of survivors, Rebecca Masika Katsuna?
Yes.
Unfortunately, I did read about her passing.
Yes.
Can you speak on that? What was she like to talk to?
She was incredible. I mean, this is a woman who, and I didn't get too into, in the film, I didn't delve too deeply into her backstory, only because it was just, I wanted to avoid kind of victimizing her and focusing more on the incredible work she was doing with these women to empower them after their rapes. But
yes. This
is a woman whose husband was killed in front of her, who was fed by rebels his genitals, which they amputated, who was gang raped. I mean, she went through an ordeal that you can't even imagine, and she spoke about that to me.
Mm.
And this is a woman who, with her ingenuity and her intelligence, was able to rise up from that experience and create this haven for victims of rape. So she was an unbelievable story. I was devastated to hear of her passing. And she actually died from a malaria-associated illness. It was not from you know, any sort of foul play, but she went way too soon. She wasn't even 50. She was 49. And she was doing so much amazing work with this community of women. So I've been working hard through my fixer. It's very hard to communicate when you're so far away, but I've been working to try to figure out, you know, who's taking over her position so that the 180 women she was supporting are not left behind.
Right. Yeah, it seems like she was really building something, working on these women's self-esteem and trying to give them something to work towards. I did want to ask about, there were some shots, very interesting breakaway to a military camp. The acronym was FARDC. I didn't get a chance to see what that stood for.
The FARDC is the military there. It's an acronym. I won't butcher the pronunciation because it's in French. But,
okay.
Yeah, but it's a French acronym, and that's the FARDC is the Congolese military.
Okay,
and it was those soldiers that were the ones responsible for the rapes in Minova, and it was those soldiers who were on trial in the film.
Gotcha.
Part of the FARDC. Yeah.
Well, I noticed there were a lot of female soldiers in that particular scene.
Yes.
Is that a recent thing? Have female soldiers always been a part of the operation? And do you think added female soldiers may help people gain trust for the military or the government?
I can't give you a specific date on when women were included in the military. I do know that it's not a very recent inclusion, but I did interview a number of the women there. I didn't end up using any of the military interviews with the female soldiers because it was very clear that they were giving me answers that were being fed by their superiors. So there was this very strong sense surrounding the military, and I think that this was particularly in the trial that was happening, which was sort of this scarlet letter on the military. So they were very conscious of my presence and wanting to create a positive facade for the military. So the interviews really lacked, authenticity. So they weren't particularly useful. But one thing that I did notice, just kind of observationally, was how I was struck by the strength and the independence and the happiness, frankly, of the women who were in the military. Most of them were unmarried. Most of them didn't have children. And they were okay with that and really happy in their lives, making their own wages, independent. So it was almost like this group of feminists, in a way, juxtaposed with the women out in the villages who were totally dependent on their husband's care, for whom marriage and family was such a part of their identity. So it was just a really dramatic juxtaposition.
That is. I've heard of, on the rebel side in Colombia, the women who have fought with the opposition FARC. It is a strangely feminist kind of collective where these rebel soldiers, a lot of them are women, and I've read cases where, these women can take up officer roles. They're not relegated to women, I guess, female duties, like, cooking and cleaning and stuff. It's a shared responsibility. I would imagine that a woman being able to fight in any of these countries could be a source of protection and pride, regardless of the fake interviews that you got, I guess. So that is very interesting. I'd like to look into that even more. I would like to ask you about the trial itself. What you were filming was something that, it was pretty monumental, and me just watching it on my couch, I'm getting so many feelings. First of all, you've got 39 potential perpetrators just sitting in a room. How did it feel to get close-up shots of these soldiers who look just blasé, uninterested? Some of them are joking around. Some of them look like they're going to fall asleep. I mean, I teach college composition, and that room looked a lot like my classroom at 8 o'clock in the morning. But for something infinitely more serious, how did it feel to just stare down the camera lens at these guys?
An interesting thing happens when you are staring at something through a lens, which was an experience, again, having not made a film before this one, that I had not experienced. There is something that creates such a remove, in a way, that you're almost able to trick your mind into believing that you're watching a film unfold, even though you're standing in front of, the subject in reality. So, I was able to kind of create that false sense of remove when I needed to in order to do my job and to do it objectively, which is so important in documentary filmmaking. To not have an agenda that you're trying to kind of force upon the viewer. So I mean, obviously, it was disconcerting. It was upsetting. But at the end of the day, I kind of needed to push those emotions aside in order to make a film that was fair and not, you know, put my prejudgments onto these subjects. So that's what I tried to achieve.
That's understandable. I mean, you got to get in there and do the job. How did it feel sitting back to watch your work later?
I think when I got home, I remember actually the day of the trial. It was one of the more emotional days for me. I got back after filming for hours and hours and hours. The trial lasted from morning until night. It was an all-day affair with no break. And I filmed it in its entirety.
Oh, geez.
So it was an exhausting physically and emotionally, you know, even though I tried to remain as removed as possible, you know, something that was as visually stunning as that trial with, you know, the one half of the room filled with soldiers, the other half empty, and the women being paraded in front of this group of judges. It was visually so stunning that it was impossible to not be affected by it. So I came home that night and just cried. I finally, you know, I shut off my camera and everything kind of washed over me, and I was just deeply affected by it. It was a tough day. So, and then rewatching the footage was an interesting experience because I had to take it through months of translation. So, you know, often I was filming things without knowing exactly what people were saying, just trying to shoot based off of energy and what I was perceiving through people's movements and the looks on people's faces. So it became this very intuitive process filming a movie in a foreign language, and then I was able to relive that experience with the dialogue once it was translated. Because the film was shot, Swahili, French, and Lingala were the three languages in the film. None of which I speak, by the way.
Sure.
And so reliving it with the stories in their complete form was again very moving on a whole other level and very informative. So,
jeez.
Yeah, it's been a real journey with this film.
I would imagine. Jeez. I think my last question regarding the film itself is, and take your time to answer this because it's probably a doozy, was this trial, do you believe, rigged from the start? Was it just set up to fail?
Rigged is such an inflammatory word. I don't know that I would go so far as to say use that particular word. What I would say is that this trial happened as a response to extreme international pressure after the events of the Minove rape. This was not something that that grew organically out of the government's, you know, desire to combat sexual violence. This was something that happened most likely only because of international outrage.
Yeah.
So in that sense, I think we entered into the trial, you know, totally authentically, and the results of the trial were incredibly disappointing, obviously. I do think, though, again, that this is a huge step in the right direction. So I'm pleased that the trial was conducted, even though it had its failures. But I would not say the trial was rigged. I think the trial was handled in some ways the best that it could be handled, given the resources and given the deeply entrenched problems within the criminal justice system, which desperately need to be addressed. But there is tremendous room for improvement, and I hope that the results of this trial will compel the Congolese government to rethink their approach to survivors of sexual violence.
Yeah, that's fair. That makes a lot of sense. And of course, there are always a lot of factors that go into starting up a trial like this. As you said, it was kind of forced. But you can't really, I mean, what can you do if you don't have the resources or the justice system to really make something stick? So, yeah, hopefully that is something that can be worked on with equal amounts of pressure in the future. Okay, something lighter. I don't want to be a stoic bummer here. For your first film, how on earth does it feel to, I don't know, end up on Netflix?
It was incredible. It actually started back even before Netflix. The film was shortlisted for the Academy Award this year for Best Documentary Short Subject, which
Oh,
was
jeez.
an incredible honor. We failed to get the nomination, unfortunately, but being on Netflix was a good consolation prize.
Sure.
And I mean, honestly, the biggest deal for me when it comes to the Netflix thing is that finally the film has an opportunity to be seen by people, and I wanted it to have a platform where it could be seen, because it's tricky getting your film out there. Distribution is the most important final step of any film, because you can't make movies in a vacuum.
No.
But now more than ever, I think there are some amazing platforms for filmmakers to get their stuff out there and to be seen. And I'm really happy that we landed at Netflix, because it's sort of the future, I think.
Well, yeah, it's practically universal. There's a Netflix platform for so many different countries. And I think most importantly, that this film kind of needs to be seen in America immediately. Most Americans kind of have a historically flat view of Africa, the country. And we just
Quotes in quotes.
we do all need a primer. An educational primer on what is going on over there, and it's not just, Sahara with that one tree. It's made up of many parts with a lot of issues, and something, I don't know, something like this is super important now, considering, we've got Boko Haram in Nigeria with tons of women being used as weapons there, and I mean, all of this stuff relates to other parts of the world, but unfortunately, it's the same thing happening, women being used.
It's a total global issue, and I think now more than ever before in human history, with things like social media, we are starting to unite as a globe and understanding that there is no other, there is no you and me. We really are in this together, and the problems of one part of the globe affect the other part of the globe, and it's something that we're going to have to combat in unity, because this is also an issue that exists in the United States. I've talked a lot with people about films like The Hunting Ground and The Invisible War, about the epidemic of sexual violence against women. So to think that somehow, we should relegate these problems to Africa or other places is absurd. It's happening everywhere, and women are really going to have to come together and fight back against it.
I mean, the quote that The Hunting Ground threw out was 1 in 4 college women are being raped, or will be. So yes, this is not just some faraway issue that we can ignore when we want. And you're right, this is a super, continuously growing technological world that brings everybody close together. We have no excuse to be ignorant.
Absolutely.
What are your future projects now that you are a almost Oscar nominee and super Netflix megastar.
Oh, wow. I like you. We need to talk more often. Did you say, what are my future projects? Is that what you asked?
Yeah, I would imagine you've got something else in the bag.
Yeah. I mean, well, you know, I'm going to be exploring both documentary filmmaking and also fiction. I have a love for reality and also for fantasy. So
sure.
Right now I'm working on a couple projects, fiction projects, mm-hmm. that I'm hoping to really move forward with in the coming months. And then I continue to be intimately involved in what's happening in Congo. I'm really lucky that mm-hmm. I left that place with some amazing friends that are more like family to me,
mm-hmm.
particularly my driver, Serge, who's like my big brother. I love him. And so we're always communicating and figuring out the next stage of the project, which is to bring the film back to Congo and screen it for the government, which is may sound like an easy thing to do, but it's like probably going to be one of the most challenging things if I'm able to pull it off.
Yeah.
So bringing it back there, because the film is entirely in its, you know, native subjects, native tongue. It's not American Western talking head. So
no.
It's really a Congolese film and should be shown to the people. So I'm working on bringing it back there, which is difficult. But we'll get it done.
I would imagine. I wish you luck in that. Jeez, that is...
Thank you.
This is grassroots kind of stuff that's happening, and I'm really excited to see women helping other women, regardless of, you know, distance. This is, like you said, this is something that we all need to join in together and deal with and hopefully conquer. But, you know, one country, one government, one military at a time, I suppose.